Well, look, I mean, what I thought we'd start off today is one of the key questions we always get is property going to carry on growing? Mm. So do you want to explain, because you're kind of an economist, you're one of the clever people with all the data, of what are the key factors that are actually involved in knowing whether capital growth is going to continue or not?
So traditionally, income growth has been a strong indicator of capital growth. And this has come in turn from having a really strong and diverse economy with lots of job opportunity. So places where businesses want to set up, where they have access to other businesses, good infrastructure. And even more recently, we've seen in some of our regional markets in New South Wales, strength occurring from cheap rent for businesses. So you've got your traditional growth drivers that come from people wanting to live in houses. And then on top of that, over time, we've seen the introduction of more, I suppose, speculative demand drivers, which are coming from low interest rates, high capital growth, and some of the tax and finance frameworks around investment, and also technology and globalization. So, for example, the opening up of investor markets, so you get a global demand for locally supplied property.
Now, we'll actually pull up a graph of the main capital cities. Now, it's going to be hard to read all the detail in there, but it's more just to get a trend. And generally, the trend's been, that's a pretty positive thing. Of all things you can invest in, Tom, that looks pretty reasonable, doesn't it?
I like that chart, the way it's slanting upwards.
Do you want to tell us a bit more technical stuff?
Sure. So what we're looking at is the median dwelling value of our capital city areas over the last 20 years. So you can see, obviously, that Sydney has had very strong growth over time, particularly in the last 3 years. I would say that there was a large surge in most of our housing markets in the early 2000s, which was due to high population growth. It was sort of a shock relative to the amount of supply of dwellings we had. And that's created kind of a lasting boost in our dwelling markets. I would say that over the last 5 years, you can see some of the smaller markets, such as the Australian Capital Territory, your Adelaide market and Hobart, have been stagnating. Thankfully, I guess that's been against quite low inflation as well. But generally, as you say, in the long run, there's been an increase in these markets.
And Tom, you're seeing buyers and sellers every day when you're auctioneering and speaking to all your agents out there. And all these sellers are saying, oh, is it the right time to sell? Is it the right time to buy? But when you look at that graph, it's pretty black and white, isn't it? Is if you're a buyer, you need to get in the market.
Yeah. Charts don't lie because they show you a longer-term picture. And sometimes, Chris, what actually happens is your average buyer is trying to pick things over a short period of time. Like they're trying to work out, is it a better month to buy now than in 4 or 5 months' times? Chris, you know very well that 10 years down the track, whether you bought a house for $1.2 million or for $1,250,000, it's irrelevant because it's probably worth $2
million. Yeah. And we've got 20 years growth there. So it goes back to 96 and obviously 2017. So it's a hell of a change. Say Sydney going from 200 grand up to kind of 900 or a million. Which is pretty big numbers. Now, a common thing is, and you mentioned before, that a big driver is wage income. And they say, look, wages aren't keeping up with house price inflation compared to what our parents were paying 20 years ago. What's the counter arguments to go against that?
Well, what that is telling us, I think, is that the wealth that is going into property is not necessarily coming just from wages and salaries. So wage growth in Australia is at a historic low, and the housing market has performed counter-cyclically relative to the economy, relative to wages. But there are other sources of wealth that exist. So, for example, if we look at self-managed super funds, the number of self-managed super funds has increased by over 100,000 funds in the last 5 years. But against that, the allocation of assets to property has remained steady at about 4%. So that tells me that there's potentially more wealth from that area coming in. You've also got foreign demand. You've got equity in property itself. So it's basically the expansion of technology and the more sophisticated financial systems that have allowed other sources of wealth than wages and salaries in the market.
Now, we'll bring up the Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane graph because, again, there's a lot of people are always saying, oh, look, we've had so much growth over the last few years. But, again, if you look at the graph, it doesn't necessarily say that it's been massive in the last 5 or 10 years. It looks at a reasonable straight line in a way.
I think that that over the last 30 years, the general trend, as you say, is a fairly steady increase. I would still argue that growth over the last 3 years has been quite unprecedented. And you can see that in the increases, particularly in Sydney. It's a very steep rate of increase. But I suppose even if you look at the final movements there, where the housing market is starting to stabilise, we're not expecting a drop that's going to mirror that increase over the last 3 years.
Yeah. And we'll, before we jump onto Tom's things, we'll jump to Perth and Darwin as well, because just because these main capital cities are looking pretty strong, it doesn't mean they all are.
Exactly. And I think the issue with Perth and Darwin is that they were heavily influenced by mining investment. So while the economies were diverse, they were small until you had a massive injection of investment from the private sector in mining. And you can see in that graph that even for the last 10 years, prices have been quite stagnant, which just highlights the importance of economic diversity.
Yeah, and certainly where there's a gap between Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane, do you expect that always going to be the case? Because it's kind of got bigger and bigger over time, hasn't it?
It's interesting to compare Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane. I think we have to remember that Brisbane is still indirectly influenced by the mining sector. Particularly jobs growth has not responded well to a winding down in the mining sector there. But the capital city markets, those three capital city markets are quite strong. I think as well, in the graph that compares Sydney and Melbourne dwellings, it's important to note that Melbourne units have not performed as strongly. So when we aggregate that data, you're going to see a larger gap in Melbourne and Sydney. And Sydney also just has some of those fundamentals which are stronger in terms of having a larger economy. Until recently, they've had higher rates of migration. So things like that are going to always drive strength in that market.
Now, Tom, I think one of these days we need to go on the Peter Switzer show that comes after this and have a property and shares debate. Do you reckon with those three graphs, then we might kind of be hands-down winners straight away?
I'd back ourselves, Chris. I'd be backing ourselves, because the reason I like property is that even those graphs, they don't have... Sometimes you look at the share market and, you know, you look at those high spikes and you think to yourself, wow, look at that, they made 40%. And then you see a year later going down. I think property people feel like, get the contracts, put them in your drawer and sleep at night.
It's like the casino people, and you always hear the stories of they made a fortune, oh, I made a million overnight the other day, but then you didn't hear about the 1.5 million drop that they lost.
Correct.
That sounds good. Now, let's jump